Under New York City, 6,800 miles of pipes carry more than 1 billion gallons of water from distant reservoirs to city faucets every day.
Most of those pipes are made out of iron and steel, but some of them are still made out of lead. It's really easy stuff to make pipes out of, but it's also toxic for humans. The city has made a lot of progress in reducing the number of lead pipes, but they still exist, and they can be a big problem for people living here.
A lot of us here at The Verge live in New York City, and some of us live in buildings where lead might still be a problem. So we're going to find out why lead in water is such bad news, and what it takes to find out if you're being exposed.
The first one, though,
that's suspect. Mm-hmm.
I think what made Flint so alarming is that we have laws to protect us from lead, and those laws were broken, and folks were told their water was safe across the city when it was not.
That's Mark Edwards, a professor of civil engineering at Virginia Tech. He helped bring the issues of drinking water in Flint, Michigan to national attention in 2014.
EPA had everything to do with creating Flint.
In Flint, this all started when the city switched water supplies as a cost-saving measure. The new water was more corrosive, and as it passed into people's homes, it ate away at the lead pipes and solder, putting lead into the water supply. Flint is currently in the last legs of an effort to replace all lead service lines in the city, which should be done by the middle of 2019. But while Flint got hit the most dramatically, other cities also have this problem. The water quality of New York City's water supply is a point of pride for the city's 8.6 million residents. And for most of them, their water is just fine, even after traveling thousands of miles through pipes. But sometimes even clean New York City water can start corroding lead piping, just like what happened in Flint. Most of the distribution pipes have been updated, but in a city as big as New York, some things fall through the cracks, and regulation doesn't cover every case. According to federal law, a given area isn't considered unsafe until more than 10% of residential water samples test above the EPA's recommended lead levels. That threshold hasn't been met in New York, but even a small percentage can still mean a lot of affected buildings, which leaves residents to just wonder.
The real problem with lead is it's a shared responsibility model, meaning the water company can't get the lead out of your house. In a city like New York, 5% of the homes probably have some pretty dangerous levels of lead. And it's up to you as the consumer to try to figure that out.
So if it's honest to figure it all out, let's try.
First, we put out a call to colleagues and friends who might have at-risk water. We focused on areas that the government has flagged as higher risk. A recent study warned against smaller, older buildings, especially those built in the 1920s and 1930s. Lead pipes and soldering weren't banned until 1986, so housing much newer than that could be suspect too. A couple of our samples came from the Bedford-Stuyvesant and Riverdale neighborhoods, which the study specifically called out. Finding lead in drinking water is tricky because even older buildings could have had their pipes replaced, so it's hard to predict whether yours is at risk. Plus, water laden with lead can look, smell, and taste exactly the same as water without the metal, so contamination is rarely obvious. But tests are available. We're starting out with a test that doesn't actually measure the amount of lead, just whether or not it's present, but that will give us a better idea of where to look. Really, any amount is scary, because lead sticks around once it gets into the body. It builds up in people's bones over time. It can affect the brain, nervous system, and kidneys. It is particularly dangerous to children because they're smaller, so smaller amounts can dramatically impact their development.
Lead adversely affects every organ system of the human body. It's particularly bad for young children, developing fetuses, pregnant mothers. Lead will mess you up.
But it's not going to get into your skin, which is why experts recommend you test at a kitchen sink and not your shower. Of the 8 tests we did, one looked like a definite yes for lead. That water came from friends living in Bedford-Stuyvesant, in Brooklyn. A few others were inconclusive. We really couldn't tell whether or not they were positive or negative. We decided to retest our sample from Bed-Stuy and another maybe, using a fancier test. For this one, you send the sample off to an outside lab and get more detailed results back. We weren't there for the collection, so we asked our friends to film it on their phones for us. The samples we're using for this test are called first draw, meaning you collect the water first thing in the morning. after it's been sitting undisturbed in your pipes all night. That'll tell you the most about the lead content in your building's pipes. If you wanted to test the pipes leading to your building, you'd flush your own pipes first by running your tap for 30 seconds. We sent both samples out, and we waited.
In the meantime, we learned something concerning. Mark Edwards has been studying all the available at-home test kits, like the while you wait test we used, and his early results are not promising.
I think I can tell you right now that I would not use those tests with confidence, that they do have an error rate, and that many times when you use them, you could have high lead in that sample, and it will tell you your water's safe.
The lab tests are more safe, but they only tell you how much lead is in your water at that one moment in time. So even if you get a low test result, if you have lead pipes, lead could easily break off and enter your water supply in the future.
What good is testing? How frequently are you going to get a low sample one time and fool yourself into thinking your water's safe? In those cases where, especially if you're vulnerable and you want to protect yourself against high lead, we know that one test is not adequate anymore.
So the question is it even worth it to test?
Should you just assume it's unsafe? Should you test it 5 times, 10 times? At what point can you have confidence? It's a real can of worms.
So it's hard to know what lessons we should even learn from our tests. And as an added twist, the lab results came back with a surprise for us. Both tests were basically negative. Our maybe sample contained lead at a very low 1 part per billion, and our positive sample had no measurable lead at all. We were pretty surprised, so we called the lab back.
This is a little bit strange because when we did this test with some initial kind of while you wait tests, it came back with kind of a positive result that showed that lead was there. Why might that have happened?
We often call these test strips random color generators because we have done our best to make sense of them ourselves, and oftentimes they seem completely arbitrary in what they produce. There are false positives and there are also false negatives. The lead can possibly hide from the strip.
What kind of advice would you give for someone who found 1 part per billion in their water?
My recommendation to anyone who detects lead in their water is to assume that it could be much worse than actually detected, right? Because it could be 6:30 on a Monday that you took the sample, but for whatever kind of local reasons are defining your personal local environment, maybe on Wednesdays, the lead is much more exposed. And so you have a 10 part per billion. So always assume the worst. You have nothing to lose. Buying these treatment products is fairly inexpensive and easy to do, and they give you a great sense of security.
For the record, a $30 water filter is cheaper than the lab test we bought. So in lots of scenarios, that may be the best option for dealing with suspect water. The takeaway from all of this is that the problem will not go away on its own. So as long as we have any lead infrastructure, we're going to keep wondering. Hey everyone, thanks for watching episode 2 of Trial and Error. We did let everyone know the results of the tests, and hopefully our friend in Kensington will get a water filter or take more tests to figure out where the lead is coming from. If you like this video, be sure to check out the others on our channel, and don't forget to like and subscribe.